Thank you. That concludes topical questions. The next item of business is a statement by Jenny Minto on diet and healthy weight consultations. The Minister will take questions at the end of her statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on Jenny Minto. Up to 10 minutes, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As the new Minister for Public Health and Women's Health, I welcome this opportunity to reaffirm the Scottish Government's vision of a Scotland where everyone eats well and has a healthy weight. In 2018, we published our Diet and Healthy Weight Delivery Plan, detailing how we would seek to improve the health of our nation with preventative action at its heart. It makes clear that to achieve Scotland's dietary goals, to realise our aim to halve childhood obesity by 2030 and reduce diet-related health inequalities requires action to support healthier options. This focus on improving health and reducing health inequalities was reiterated by the First Minister in the new policy perspective, Equality, Opportunity, Community, New Leadership, A Fresh Start. Today, I will provide updates on the outcome of three consultations: ending the sale of energy drinks to children and young people, mandating calorie labelling in the out-of-home sector, and restricting promotions of food and drink in high in fat, sugar or salt where they are sold to the public. The views gathered in these consultations have helped us ensure that our policies are evidence-based, proportionate and designed to deliver positive outcomes for public health. The independent analysis reports for these three consultations were published today on the Scottish Government's website. Firstly, I will provide an update on our consultation on ending the sale of energy drinks to children and young people. The aim of this consultation was to inform our consideration of whether there is sufficient cause and evidence to mandate restrictions on their sale. An evidence-based approach is central to the development of our policy. We have carefully considered the responses received in conjunction with the current evidence base and today published an evidence brief on energy drinks alongside the consultation analysis report. Based on these considerations, we do not consider the evidence base to be sufficiently developed to pursue mandatory measures at this time. I recognise that consumption of energy drinks is a significant concern to parents, teachers and young people. We will therefore continue to support voluntary measures to restrict the sale of energy drinks to children and will keep under review how these could be strengthened. We will also consider what additional evidence gathering and analysis could be undertaken. This includes around the impacts of current voluntary actions and understanding young people's consumption of energy drinks and the contribution this makes to their total caffeine intake, which will help to inform consideration of possible mandatory measures in the future. Next, I turn to our consultation on mandating calorie information in the out-of-home sector, fulfilling a commitment in our 2021 Out-of-Home Action Plan. This consultation was accompanied by a rapid evidence review carried out by Food Standards Scotland, which found that mandating calorie labelling would likely lead to a reduction of calorie intake when eating out or ordering in. In January this year, Nesta, the UK's innovation agency for social good, published research confirming that calorie labelling in an online environment leads to calorie reduction. This was potentially a substantial reduction depending on how calorie information was presented. Out-of-home calorie labelling has been mandated for large businesses in England since April last year. This has resulted in many UK-wide high street chains now including such information on their menus in outlets in Scotland. I am grateful to all 660 respondents to our consultation and to the wide range of business, health, charity and consumer organisations that engaged with my officials. A strong case has been made by many respondents that requiring calorie information at the point of choice where people eat out or order in will help them make more informed, healthier choices, and that it will encourage reformulation and allow us to better monitor population calorie intakes in the home, out-of-home situation. I also want to thank the Eating Disorders charity Beat for the constructive way in which it has engaged with our consultation. Beat has helped us to hear from people affected by eating disorders who are concerned that mandatory calorie labelling will make their illness worse. These accounts are powerful. They are real. and we cannot ignore them. We need a better understanding of the lived experiences of those with an eating disorder. I welcome that Public Health Scotland has commissioned research on this issue due in the autumn. We are committed to assessing the impact of our policies and are reflecting on all the responses gathered, including those views of people affected by eating disorders. We also wish to have further discussions with the hospitality sector before taking a decision to proceed with this measure. Therefore, I believe that we should pause before making a final decision on the next steps in relation to mandating calorie labelling. Let me now turn to the third consultation on restricting the promotion of less healthy food and drink where they are sold to the public. We know that promotions such as multi-buy offers or placements at checkouts can directly influence what people buy. That's what they are designed to do. Promotions can encourage us to buy things we don't need, overlooking cheaper, healthier alternatives. Restricting promotions of less healthy food and drink is an important step to encourage healthier options, making it easier for people to spend less and make healthier choices. Work on this policy was paused in 2020 as we sought to ascertain the impact of the COVID-19 pandemic on both consumers and businesses. We have used this time to gather and consider additional evidence on our proposals while taking into account the pandemic action in other parts of the UK, EU exit and cost of living pressures. Building on a previous consultation before the COVID-19 pandemic, we consulted on our proposals last summer, including on opportunities to be consistent with promotion restrictions in England, where it is in Scotland's best interest to do so. We keep our policies and the plans for their delivery under regular review, with evaluation firmly embedded into the policy-making, implementation and delivery cycle. Having done this important work, we have reviewed whether primary legislation is necessary and have concluded there is a more direct and efficient route to deliver our policy aims. Therefore, rather than introduce the Public Health Restriction of Promotions Bill, I instead plan to consult on the detail of proposed regulations this autumn. This includes proposals to restrict the promotion of less healthy food and drinks in prominent locations in store, for example at the end of aisles and beside checkouts. We also propose to target certain price promotions which encourage people to buy more than they actually need, for example multi-buys and unlimited refills. I recognise that businesses, as well as individuals, have experienced a number of significant challenges over the last few years. Our forthcoming consultation will provide an opportunity for them to provide views on the detail of the proposed regulations, including on timescales for implementation. In line with the principles of the New Deal for Business, this will be done in parallel with an extensive programme of engagement to ensure everyone has an opportunity to engage and have their voice heard. My officials and I look forward to engaging with our stakeholders, including businesses, as our policy continues to develop. Furthermore, we will continue to work with the Joint Regulatory Task Force and COSLA to consider the differing impacts of regulation on business to improve the process of developing, implementing and reviewing regulations to meet our economic and societal aims for the longer term. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, I have focused today on the outcomes of three diet-related consultations and our planned next steps. These include on energy drinks, the continued support of voluntary measures to restrict the sale of energy drinks to children while keeping under review how these could be strengthened, including the consideration of additional evidence gathering and analysis to inform further consideration of possible mandatory measures in the future. In mandating calorie labelling, to allow more time to consider the potential impact of mandating calorie labelling on those with an eating disorder, ensuring we have a robust evidence base to further inform any additional steps that we might take in due course. And finally, on restrictions of promotions, I will be taking forward a more focused consultation in the autumn on the detail of proposed regulations to restrict the promotion of less healthy food and drink where they are sold to the public. Clearly, no policy in isolation can achieve our vision of a Scotland where everyone eats well and has a healthy weight. Our diet and healthy weight delivery plan sets out a challenging package of actions that collectively will have a greater impact. As I take stock of progress, I commend the work to date, while noting there is still more to be done. I remain committed to the key outcomes of the delivery plan, and I'm confident that together with our public, private and third sector partners, by progressing the commitments set out today, we can meet these challenges and encourage people to make healthier choices about food.
Thank you. The Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which we'll move on to the next item of business. And I'd be grateful if members who wish to ask a question were to press their request to speak buttons now. And I call Sandesh Gulhani.
As a practising GP, the obesity crisis that has developed in Scotland is something I am all too familiar with. Our country has one of the worst records in the world on obesity, with two-thirds of all adults in Scotland being overweight. Make no mistake, obesity is one of the biggest issues in our health service, estimated to cost up to £600 million a year. But for some reason, and this is an issue that the SNP have declined to take action on for the past 16 years, the prevalence of overweight people has increased over the past 10 years. The percentage of children at a healthy weight is at its lowest ever level. This statement does little to actually address the obesity epidemic sweeping across Scotland. The Minister's statement amounts to, one, energy drinks, we won't do this, two, mandating calorie labelling, we're not sure, three, restrictions of promotions, let's do some more thinking. What was the point of this statement? How much money has been spent to date on these consultations? And what actual concrete work and action is the Minister taking?
Minister.
I thank Sandesh Gulhani for his questions. I would refute that the Scottish Government has been doing nothing. For the last 5 years, there has been a lot of evidence being gathered to ensure that we bring in the right policies for the right people within Scotland. We have got a whole suite of policies. It's not just, as I said at the end of my statement, it is not just these that I have discussed in this statement. We are also looking at giving the child payment, which allows people on the poverty gap to have the money in their pockets to allow them to purchase the right foods. We've also there's also a number of pieces of work, regulations that have been brought in on a voluntary level, which the Scottish Government supports as well in the work that they are doing. So we are moving forward. We are ensuring that we bring in the right policies for the right people, listening to groups. For example, I talked about BEAT and people with food crisis illnesses. And we are listening to them to ensure that the policy that we bring in with regard to calorie limits on out-of-home eating are correct and proportionate and proper.
I call Carol Mockin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The importance of getting this right cannot be overstated. Delivering positive and tangible actions to improve diet and tackle obesity is crucial to improving the health of the nation and eradicating health inequalities. However, yet again, we have another ministerial statement that shows little to no progress. They are a government that is no stranger to a strategy, but has a terrible relationship with delivery. The Minister should be here to explain why the SNP Scottish Government have made so little progress in this area since the plan was established 5 years ago. Please explain why so little progress has been made.
Minister.
I disagree that little progress has been made. We have been working hard with stakeholders across healthy eating and also businesses to ensure that we bring in the right policies. You need to have, as I've said in my statement, we need to have robust evidence and support to ensure that we bring in the right policies that will impact on the right people.
I call Evelyn Tweed to be followed by Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what steps they are taking to support community kitchen initiatives that support those on low incomes to access the right tools and resources to help them eat a healthy diet.
Minister.
I thank Evelyn Tweed for her question. It's a really important one. Community food networks help promote healthier diets in disadvantaged groups, whether that's due to lack of income, cultural barriers or poor skills. They provide a broad range of activities, including cooking classes, benefit checks, grow your own groups, cafes and food pantries. We've also provided the online resource Eat Well Your Way, which was launched last year by Food Standards Scotland, and this gives easy access to evidence-based advice on how to eat well based on the Eat Well guide.
Craig Hoy, to be followed by Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister spoke of having further discussions with the hospitality sector before taking a decision around the issue of mandatory calorie labelling in the out-of-home sector. Our struggling hospitality sector has been ignored all too often in the past by this government, and it can't be allowed to happen again. So can the Minister please outline what form she sees those discussions taking place and when they will start?
Minister.
I thank Craig Hoy for that question. I was clear in my statement that we need to involve business in these decisions, but we have to get the balance right between public health and business. With regards to the new deal that this government is operating on, there is a wish to speak more directly with business and understand the concerns, because I recognise the points that you raised with regard to level of regulations coming through. However, I think we'll get the best solutions working with business to ensure that we can bring things in a timely manner that allows them to work with us to ensure that the public health benefits are met.
Emma Harper, to be followed by Claire Baker.
There is significant evidence which shows that ultra-high processed foods directly link to obesity, poor diet, malnourishment and negative health implications. Can the Minister describe some of the specific policy work that is being carried out to use the evidence related to ultra-high processed food, which particularly impacts low-income families, to help improve diet and health outcomes?
Minister.
I thank Emma Harper for her question. I'm aware that the Scientific Advisory Committee on Nutrition considered ultra-processed foods in June last year, and that they are now carrying out a scoping review of the evidence on ultra-processed foods and health with a view to publishing a position paper on processed foods and health this summer. Ministers and Food Standards Scotland remain committed to using the latest scientific consensus of established evidence to inform our consideration of ultra-processed foods, and will consider the findings of this review once available. While there is no universally agreed definition of ultra-processed foods, we know that many processed foods are high in fat, sugar or salt, which can contribute to diet-related conditions. Those HFSS foods in targeted food and drink categories would be subject to proposed promotions and restrictions.
Claire Baker, to be followed by Claire Hawhey.
Thank you. So organisations and professionals who've argued for action will be bitterly disappointed by this statement today. Obesity Action Scotland earlier this month asked itself, so can Scotland halve childhood obesity by 2030? Based on the current direction of travel, the answer is almost certainly no. So I'd ask the Minister, how much more evidence gathering is there going to be when the results of inaction are staring us in the face? And for example, out of our sector, kids' food is too often unhealthy food. So what action are they going to take to tackle children's poor choices in the out-of-house sector?
Minister.
I thank the Member for her question. As I said earlier, I believe it's important that we ensure we get the right robust evidence to ensure that we're bringing in the right policies. We have, as I've said before, we have also brought in a number of policies to support the reduction of obesity in children. As we took evidence from the Good Food Nation Bill, we learnt that in local authorities where the 1140 hours was allowing more time to be spent with children, ensuring they got nutritious, healthy food, that then had a knock-on effect with regards to the food choices that they were making later on in primary school. And within primary school, we have really improved the choice of food there. It's not a one-stop shop. There will be a lot of different things that can change and also bring the obesity levels down. With regard to out-of-home eating, there has been work done on a voluntary basis to discuss what is in the menus, and that is an improvement, and that's what I'm working with my officials to ensure we get the right information to enable us to make the right policy decisions to ensure that we do meet the ambition of halving childhood obesity by 2030.
Claire Hawhey, to be followed by Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Minister provide more detail about how the Scottish Government will ensure that businesses have sufficient time to prepare for the implementation of restriction of promotions of unhealthy food and drinks?
Minister.
We plan to consult on the detail of proposed regulations this autumn, with a plan to lay regulations before Parliament next year, subject to the outcome of that consultation. There will be a period between regulations being laid before Parliament and regulations coming into force to enable industry to fully prepare. Our consultation this autumn will include consulting on an appropriate lead-in time for businesses ahead of regulations coming into force. Our prior engagement with stakeholders has been on the basis that these restrictions would not come into force before 2025 at the earliest. This still remains the case. We recognise the challenges that businesses are experiencing in the current economic climate, and we have and will continue to engage widely with business stakeholders on business impacts and are developing a suite of impact assessments for the policy, including a business regulatory impact assessment.
Alex Cole-Hamilton, to be followed by Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We've just heard that there will be opposed to steps to bring forward mandatory calorie counting on menus. This is very welcome. The evidence of harm to those with or at risk of eating disorders is widespread, and that's why Scottish Liberal Democrats have opposed such plans from the outset. But it's not just Lib Dems that oppose it. Stakeholders named in the statements do too, but also 80% of respondents to the government's own consultation. So can I ask the Minister, what does she expect opposed to tell her that she doesn't already know? And why not just answer the calls of campaigners by axing and scrapping these plans entirely?
Minister.
I thank the member for his question. I think it is important to review the population as a whole and not just make decisions on one element of the population. We have taken cognizance of what decisions have been made in England, and we are looking to gather further information with regards to speaking to BEAT and looking to see how we can work with them to provide the right information, whether it's online, which allows people to make a decision as to what they are purchasing for out-of-home food, and also on restaurants and fast food restaurant menus as they have brought in England.
Jackie Dunbar, to be followed by Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Minister outline what the Scottish Government considers could be the broad benefits of restricting promotions on unhealthy food and drink, and how this fits in with the Scottish Government's focus on improving health and reducing health inequalities?
Minister.
I thank Jackie Dunbar for her question. I am clear that I want to reduce public health harms associated with the excess consumption of calories, fat, sugar and salt, including the risks of developing type 2 diabetes, various types of cancer and other conditions such as cardiovascular disease. I also want to reduce diet-related health inequalities, including in relation to socio-economic disadvantage. The food environment is often skewed towards the promotion of less healthy food and drink, encouraging extra spend and higher calorie intake, as I referenced in my statement. Promotions don't necessarily represent good value. They can encourage us to buy things we don't need, overlooking cheaper, healthier alternatives. By restricting the promotion of less healthy food and drink, we will make it easier for people to spend less and make healthier food choices. Changes to the food environment, such as restricting promotions, are likely to be more effective in reducing health inequality.
Oliver Mundell, to be followed by Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's often easier to ban things and demonise those who are overweight than encourage and empower people to make positive lifestyle choices. With only one in five adults in Scotland eating the recommended five portions of fruit and veg a day, a figure that has remained unchanged since this Parliament was created, what practical steps are the Scottish Government taking to ensure those who live in Scotland, a food-rich nation, can benefit from affordable local produce, promoting good health and supporting our farmers?
Minister.
I thank Oliver Mundell for his question, and I agree it is a holistic approach we need to take to this. We need to support people to make the right lifestyle choices. One of the ways that the Scottish Government is moving in that direction is with the Good Food Nation Act, which will ensure that local authorities, the Scottish Government provides a plan as and local authorities and also health boards, and I think that's incredibly important. I think you're right, local food is incredibly is a great way to ensure that we can do this, and not only from a food mile perspective, but also adding the economic benefit to our farmers and food growers. I think across Scotland there are fantastic opportunities for local organisations, and I referenced them in Evelyn Tweed's conversation, where communities have got community gardens which allow them to grow. So not only are they getting the healthy food, they're also getting the exercise to improve their general well-being. And I think that's the point that I've been trying to make, is that this is a holistic solution that we need to solve this. And I'm very supportive of local food initiatives, as well as what's happening with the Good Food Nation Act.
Julian Mackay, to be followed by Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The consultation analysis report on energy drinks highlights that respondents suggested the need to focus on education about energy drinks, on the labelling of energy drinks, and the need for an easily understood and straightforward definition of energy drinks and which drinks would be captured under that definition. Can the Minister advise what action is being taken to address these concerns?
Minister.
I thank Gillian Mackay for her question. Yes, I agree. We have to have a clear labelling, and there is a code of practice that ensures that there is that level of labelling on energy drinks. Energy drinks are defined as ones that are over 150 milligrams per litre of caffeine, and I think it is important that that signage is very clear on these drinks. I think also it's important to point out that in primary schools, these are not allowed to be provided within the school estate. And in secondary schools, as part of the curriculum for excellence, that pupils are taught about energy drinks and only given them at a time so they can recognise that it's almost a treat. Certainly that's the way I grew up, so that it was normally water, and except you get a treat for energy drinks. So I think there's a number of ways that we're trying to do this, but I think key is making sure that there's the right information on the cans.
Rona Mackay, to be followed by Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I ask the Minister to expand on how the Scottish Government has engaged with those with lived experience in relation to calorie labelling? And will the Scottish Government commit to continue to listen to their views going forward?
Minister.
I thank Rona Mackay for her question. The Scottish Government has engaged extensively with BEAT, the largest charity for people with an eating disorder, throughout the consultation process. I'm also grateful for the large number of responses to our consultation from people with eating disorder, their family members, friends and carers. We will continue to engage with BEAT once Public Health Scotland has completed its research into the impact of calorie labelling on the lived experience of people with an eating disorder. We are committed to taking into account how calorie labelling might affect those individuals.
And Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The recent Health Inequalities in Scotland report cited a 24-year gap in the time spent in good health between people living in the most and least deprived 10% of local areas in Scotland. The reality is that making healthier choices is a privilege for many people in Scotland. So does the Minister accept that the Government has to address the root cause of health inequalities in order to improve health outcomes?
Minister.
I thank Paul Sweeney for that question, and as I have said in previous answers, I believe it is a holistic approach that we need to take. And yes, we need to work very closely with those suffering health inequalities. The child payment is one of these. I've referenced that earlier. It puts the money directly into people's hands to allow them to make these decisions, and I think that's incredibly important. And we also work closely within the wider public health to support communities across Scotland to ensure that they are, along with third sector colleagues and partners, to ensure that the support that members of various communities get is really helpful with regards to healthy eating and also well-being and also exercise, which ties in as importantly with the healthy food that people eat as well.
Thank you. That concludes the Ministerial Statement on Diet and Healthy Weight Consultations. The next item will begin in a moment.